So, my name is Louise Bavro. I am honored to conduct an interview with Sonja Glassman. Today's date is April 16th, 2021, and the interview is being conducted in San Diego, California, and the language is in English. So, good afternoon, Sonja. How are you?
Hello, Louise. I'm fine. Thank you.
Good. So I'd like to start out this this interview by asking you, what is your complete name and would you spell it so we have the correct spelling?
All right. Sonja, S-O-N-J-A, Glassman, G-L-A-S-S-M-A-N. And my maiden name is Kalter, K-A-L-T-E-R.
Did you have any nicknames or any other names you went by?
Well, when I was little, they used to call me Sonale. And other than that, I'm always Sonja.
Sonja, when and where were you born?
I was born in Leipzig, Germany, in 1938, August 29th.
Do you have any, you were so young, so I doubt it, but do you have any memories of all of Leipzig, or you left before you were too young, correct?
Well, my personal, I couldn't remember, but I, from my stories that I hear, of course, from my parents, I was born on the kitchen table because Jewish doctors were not allowed to be in hospitals anymore. And my father, I believe, until the doctor finally arrived, he helped somewhat in my birthing. And it was fortunately or unfortunately a very, very tough time. It was right at the time when Hitler was trying to get everybody out of Germany, all the Polish Jews and even the German Jews.
What was your address in Leipzig?
My address was, I know it was number 11, and I know it was in the Gohlis neighborhood, a very lovely neighborhood. And I forget, it's a long name for the street. I can't give you the street name. I can look it up later if you want.
We'll go back to talking about this in a minute, but what were your parents' names?
My parents, my mother was Erna or Else, and she was a born Eisenberg. My father was Josef, and last name Kalter, of course.
And where were they born?
My mother was born in Germany, in Hanover. And my father was born in Tarnów in Poland. So he had a Polish passport.
But he came to Germany, correct? Is that how he met your mother?
Yeah, my father came to Germany with his family. He was the youngest of seven children. And they came when he was 3 years old, he came to Germany. And they actually met when they were quite young, because the Leipzig community was very tight-knit in those days, and they all knew each other. And my mother had four brothers. She was the only girl. So her brothers became friendly with my father at a young age.
Do you know why your father moved from Poland?
Yes, I believe they felt that they would have a better life in Germany. Poland was not great. They were in a little town, Tarnów. My grandfather had a, you know, they were very meager income. I think he dealt in secondhand clothing or whatever, but he felt he could maybe get a better life in Germany.
Let's talk a little bit about. I'm sorry. My microphone fell down. Forgive me. What was your father's occupation?
Well, when he was still in Germany, he worked somewhat with my mother's father in the dry goods business. And then when we had to leave Germany and we were refugees, he wasn't allowed to work in Switzerland during the war. And then after the war, he got into the fur business. He was doing import and export business. And when we were in the States, that's what he continued to do.
How would you describe your father?
All right. Like I said, he was the youngest of seven children. And he was brought up in a religious home, very religious home. And during the years when I was growing up with my father, he was a very sedate, very sad person in many ways because he lost most of his family. And but he was very, very devoted to his family and a religious man. He was Orthodox. I was brought up in an Orthodox home. And I know he was a hard worker. He tried to provide for the family, and he enjoyed, he enjoyed reading, and he enjoyed music. He enjoyed watching boxing when we were here, too. So, yeah, he was a dear man.
Do you have a memory?
Can't hear you.
Do you have any particular memories when you were a younger girl, little girl, that you, any fond memories you'd like to tell of you and your father together?
Yes, well, I think there were many, he would take me out for walks, and we were in Zurich at that point when we were little. One of the things, I was a very, very poor eater. I didn't eat very much. I was very thin. And he would spend hours with me at the table trying to get me to eat. And he would tell me about, this is for Uncle so-and-so, and take a spoonful for cousin this. And of course, the children all over are starving, and that's for them. So he would spend a lot of time with me, on that. It didn't help much. And he would take us in Zurich. He would take us on, downtown to the lake, and would spend time with us. And I have one sharp memory when I was probably about three. He took me downtown, and he stopped at a kiosk to look at the news. And somehow I let go of his hand, or he let go of mine, and I walked away. And I kept walking, and I took somebody's hand at some point, and it wasn't my father. So they realized that I was lost, and they took me to the police station. And he must have been frantic, my father. I think he went home, and finally he went, somehow they connected. It was way before, phones, iPhones, you couldn't connect with anybody. And I remember at the police station, they treated me very nicely. I was able to use a typewriter, and they gave me an apple. And I didn't speak that clearly. At that point, when they asked me my name, one nickname I had was Flo, which means a little flea. And because I couldn't say R for a long time, and when I wanted to say Ich bin froh, I would say Ich bin Flo. So, I'm happy, but I say it wrong. So they didn't know what my name was, the police, but somehow we got together again. And then growing up, my father was supportive. He was not demonstrative necessarily. But later on, which I'll get into maybe later, we found a lot of letters that he wrote during the war. And he was just always talking about his two daughters, because I had a sister who, I still have a sister. She's 2.5 years older, So that's how I would describe him. But he, like I said, there was a sadness about him, and I will probably tell you more about that. So,
Is there anything else you'd like to say about your father at this point?
I'll explain more, I think, later on as we get into some of the other events.
Hey, let's go on now to your mother. Describe your mother. Did she have an occupation?
No. She, you know, when she was growing up, she was artistic, and she wanted to become a fashion designer. But in those days, girls did not go to, certainly not to art school. And she was discouraged from doing any of that. She did learn to play the piano. She got quite good at it, and she played through several, you know, even when she was older, she still played. And again, when we, she was a very good seamstress. And actually, while my sister and I were growing up, she sewed all our clothes and she knitted. And when we got to the States, she started a business of her own, doing alterations and new dresses and so on. So we helped her with that.
Okay, Sonja, we're going to take Sonja, we're going to take a break for a minute. I think there might be a little problem. We're just going to take a break. 1 minute.
Okay.
Okay, so now to get back to your mother, how would you describe her, her character, her personality? What would you say about her?
My mother was a very optimistic person. And again, you know, they went through really, really hard times, and she had health problems that were very definitely connected to all her hardships that she was experiencing. But aside from that, she was an optimistic person. She was always, available as a mother. I think we both of us had wonderful relationship with her. She also enjoyed and supported what we did in school and with our ambitions. And so she was loving and wonderful mother.
Do you have any special memories you'd like to share as a child growing up with her?
I have to get into the other part of my whole story to explain everything. My memories, of course, of her, you know, I know she was always busy making some clothing for us. She was always busy with cooking, and we always helped her. You know, this was all during the war, so it's not as though we had any really special events together. It was a matter of getting through whatever we needed to get through.
Did your mother sing any favorite tunes or lullabies to you or anything that you remember?
Yeah. I think the famous one, I guess it's Brahms, you know, Guten Abend, Gute Nacht. Or maybe it's not Brahms, but she did. When going to sleep, which I then sang to my grandchildren. That's a nice little lyric of how the angels will take care of you overnight, you know. So, and like I said, we also went on outings together whenever we could. Zurich is a lovely town. We had a little lake, and you could go to parks, and that was always nice.
Anything else you'd like to say about your mother at this point before we move on?
Not right now. I think it'll come up again with my other story.
Do you remember your grandparents?
No, I'm afraid I never had any grandparents, except, well, my father's parents, I never met, and my mother's parents, her mother died right after the war ended, that they were liberated, and my mother's father, after the war, he visited us in Switzerland for about a week or so, 2 weeks, and I just really met him for a very short time, but I didn't really know them.
What were their names?
My mother's father was Samuel. He was Samuel. And my father's father was Baruch. And what was his mother's offhand? I forgot. I have it somewhere. I remember my mother's mother, her maiden name. She was Konigsberg. So, but offhand, I can't remember her.
Did they? Some of them perish during the Holocaust. What happened to them?
Well, my father's parents, in 1938, when we had to leave Germany, they were still in Tarnów, his parents, in Poland. And his mother died, she got sick, and she died of natural causes. But his father was taken out. Well, when the Nazis came to the town, he was taken and shot, and so he died there. And they had three sons. They, of course, my father's siblings, I'll have to separate some of the stories there, but we didn't really know at the time, what happened to most of his family, because communication was very difficult. And it was after the war that we started to find out what had happened. But my grandparents, I suppose they were somewhat saved before all the real horrors of the camps and all of that came about. They were old enough. Maybe that was a grace that they died naturally. My mother's father, he died then in England, and he died of cancer. But they had escaped too. I mean, they also had a story, So, but again, I can relate some of these things a little better as we go on.
Is there anything else you'd like to say about your grandparents before we move on?
Yeah, unfortunately, I never really had grandparents, So when I had my grandchildren, I wanted to be really engaged, and I was lucky. They were near me, and I bonded with them. I took care of them once a week. I took off from work, And they are grown up now, and we are good friends. So I've been very, very fortunate to be able to do that.
Do you have any siblings?
I have an older sister. She was born 2.5 years before me, and very important person in my life. She was always a protector. And again, I'll probably talk more about that. My brother, I have a younger brother who's 7 years younger than I am. He was born in Switzerland. So he is not officially one of the survivors, because he didn't live in Germany at that time. So,
what is your sister's name?
Rachel. And she's now Rachel Kuberski. That's her married name. And of course, her maiden name, Coulter. And my brother's name is Norbert. He is quite Orthodox, And they call him Naftali by his Hebrew name. But I call him Norbert. So he's my baby brother.
Let's talk about your sister. First of all, what was her name? What is her name, I should say?
Rachel, my sister.
And how would you describe her?
Well, we're very much alike, and yet we've had very different lives. She has just finished her memoirs, actually, and she has done a lot of research. She loves music. She's devoted to music. She and I share great love for gardening, the outdoors. We have always been very, very close, and even though we've had very different lives, but like I said, we've shared a lot. She's always been a big reader. She introduced me a great deal to classical music and to some great authors. She studied some German. She kept up her reading of German, and she translated a lot of German letters that she found in the writing of her memoirs. She's a loving mother, loving grandmother, and an always loving sister. So, and I'll show you a picture later.
Do you have any special memories you'd like to share growing up, like in Switzerland, let's say? You know,
in Switzerland.
Of your sister.
Of my sister. Oh, I have many. Yeah. Well, like I said, we were very close. We had to, you know, we knew that something terrible was going on in the world, but my parents were very, very strict about not telling us anything bad that was happening. But we knew that we could never really ask for anything. We always felt, and I guess we were told, that we were lucky that we were alive and we had our parents, you know. So Rachel and I had to invent a lot of toys and games. I think she got a doll once, and unfortunately I was the little sister and I accidentally dropped it and broke it, you know, but she forgave me. And we would invent little games between the two of us. We had a little store that we made clay things, you know, vegetables with and so on. And then as we grew up, one of the things I mentioned, my mother, she had a lot of downtime. She had illnesses with her stomach and gallbladder and so on. And so we were often sent away to refugee camps, which they did have in Switzerland. And Rachel and I usually were sent away together in one place, and she would sort of watch out for me. I was always the little sister dragging along, you know. The nice thing about some of those places that we were sent to, the refugee camps, was that they were in the country, and that was probably my love of discovering the beauty of nature and beauty of the surroundings, you know. And my sister, she also would try to take me to opera, to concerts, and she was a big influence in my life and still is. She is a mentor. She's encouraged me with my art, and, you know, so it's a good relationship that I value.
Anything else you'd like to share about your sister at this point?
No, I think more will come up as I go along.
Would you like to say something about your brother? How would you describe him and your relationship growing up?
Okay. Well, I was 7 when he was born, and it was a thrill to have a little baby, and it was a thrill to have a boy in the family. And we grew up, he was sort of the prince in the family, though. He never had to do anything. And so he and I think we kind of occasionally rubbed each other the wrong way, you know, pressed the wrong buttons. Rachel, who was older, she was much more mother-like. You know, she was a mother towards him. She was obviously 9.5 years older. So, and then for a while, he, we were quite close because he was a teenager and I was already married and I had a baby and he would come and babysit for us and he would bring us the Beatles records and so he introduced us to, you know, all of that. And then he became much more religious and our lives kind of split up a little bit more. And right now he's in Florida and I'm here and we're not that close. I mean, it's you know, we're brother and sister and he has a big family though. He had 6 children. He unfortunately lost one son, but he has about 30 grandchildren and 4 or 5 already great-grandchildren. And I keep saying that he has done his job of repopulating the Coulter family. So that's where I am at with him.
Now, I know you said you were very young when you left Leipzig, but is there anything you could tell us about the city that maybe your father and mother or your sister discussed about? What was it like, you know, the city of Leipzig, the Jewish population? Oh, yeah. Anything you could shed some light
sure.
on the city?
I can very much so because my sister has done a tremendous amount of research on Leipzig in her at that time, I'll go back to the time when I was born. Yes, there was a big Jewish community. Both my parents went to the Karlbach school, which was started by Rabbi Karlbach, and it was a very good school. And it was a very cosmopolitan city. It was famous, you know, for business and commerce and culture. So Mendelssohn lived there, I believe, and of course Bach was a big influence. So it was, you know, the Jews felt comfortable and they were integrated into the city, into the whole social system. Jews were doctors, lawyers. They participated in the community and in the culture and so on. So when things turned around, it was such a shock, you know, and people said, well, that can't happen, which we can't ever say again, I'm sure. But like I think I mentioned to you, I did go back to Leipzig now. It has, well, even then, it has a beautiful park, the Rosenthal Park, and a zoo, a wonderful zoo. And my mother always told me about, because on the Sabbath, when they couldn't do anything, they would take walks in the park. And I believe I sat on a bench that she may have sat on many years ago when I went back to see the park. And it's a lovely park. It's very natural. It's not, you know, manicured. Beautiful old trees and little lake. So it's a beautiful city, and they've restored a lot. Leipzig was destroyed, unfortunately, during Kristallnacht. There was a lot of destruction, but now it's beautifully restored, and the house that I was born in is still there. So it was quite an experience to go back.
Is there anything else you'd like to say that your parents may have shared with you or your sister who is a little bit older than you about Leipzig that would be of interest, particularly with the Jewish population and the non-Jewish? Did the Jews get along well with the non-Jews? How was it?
I believe so. I don't think, you know, it was like I said, it was an accepted thing because they were part of the whole, the Jews worked with non-Jews, you know, doctors worked with non-Jewish doctors, and music was something I think that connected everybody together and all the other cultural events and so on. There were several, I'm sure that there were, you know, several synagogues, and like I said, they lived though within close, mostly because on the Sabbath you can't travel to see anybody, so they always lived near each other, and family was close.
Did your parents have any political affiliations in Germany that you're aware of?
No, they didn't, that I know of, not. My father, you know, went to the Olympics in 1936 because he was athletic and he enjoyed watching the athletes. And he went with a camera so that when they all got up and did the Heil Hitler, he got up and took a picture that he didn't have to do the Heil Hitler. But he was there, you know. And yeah, I mean, by 1936, 37, Jews began to realize that things were precarious, you know, so that some people obviously left fairly early. And my father, being the youngest, thought that they should leave. His older brother, who was 20 years older than he, said, no, it will be okay. Nothing, you know, can't happen. Anything bad can't happen. So they stayed. Because that's one question we asked. Why did you wait so long? And that was the answer. It couldn't, stuff like that can't happen. You know, killing of. But, anyway, they did begin to feel uneasy. And that's probably was a time when people started to think about leaving. And
so what circumstances did your family leave Germany? Now, I know you said you were very young, so you want to backtrack and tell us
why
they decided and what happened?
Okay, I'll tell you. And I was born in August 1938, right? October 1938 was when the order came to take all Polish citizens, and that includes the whole family, because whatever the father is, everybody else is, you know. Supposedly, the Polish citizens had to go back to Poland to have their passport reinstated so that they could either stay in Poland or go back to Poland. This was called, had a certain name, this program. It was Hitler's idea that if they went to Poland, that they would not come back. It was a starting point of getting rid of the Jews from Germany. So we were ordered in October, we and all of my father's family and hundreds of other Jews were ordered to the station, the railroad station, where we were supposedly going to go to Poland. You had to leave your stuff behind. You could take a certain amount of things with you. But the mantra was that you'd come back to where you lived and so on. We were at the station. Now, my mother, whose father had been in Poland just shortly before that on business, he had written a letter, whatever you do, do not come to Poland. Things are not good here. But here we were at the station. My parents were only married about 3 years. They have two little kids. They were in their early 30s. My father's family was there. And he had gotten a visa to Switzerland earlier in the year because he wanted to have my mother take her to Switzerland to recuperate from giving birth. So he says, my father all the time said through a miracle, he went up to somebody and said, you know, I have a visa to Switzerland, can you let us go? And that guy let him go, and he quickly left with us from the station. And he called it a miracle. But later on, we found out from a nephew of his who was there also that it wasn't such a miracle. My father really had already given some people money to take out of Germany and bring it to Switzerland or wherever we would be able to go. And he did ask a guard if he could take me to change my diapers. And the guard said, okay. And he quickly took us into a taxi and we went to the Polish consulate, where the Polish consul allowed people, whoever could get there, he gave them shelter for a couple of days, because the edict to send the Poles out of Germany was expired after 2 days. So we were able to have some haven with the Polish consulate, and he saved a lot of lives. And in the meantime, of course, my father's family, they were shipped off, and I'll go into that a little more also. But for us then, we were able to go back to our apartment, which had already been cleaned of Jews, you know, because the Nazis went through all the apartments and made sure they were Judenrein, without Jews. The landlady allowed us to go back to the apartment, which was quite brave of her. And we were in hiding there for several weeks until we could get final papers to go to Switzerland. And my mother couldn't let me cry. She had to, you know, and she couldn't really, she always kids me, she had to toilet train me at 8 weeks, you know, because there was no way to really have a baby in an apartment and not make any noise, you know. So in that was in October, and we spent several weeks. My mother went to the consul pretty much on a regular basis, and until she got the right stamps and the papers and so on. And then in November, beginning of November, we were still there for Kristallnacht. And again, there was another, you know, it was a terror evening. And I think my parents went somewhere and somebody came to take care of us. And but we got through that. And by the end of November, by November 26, my mother and I were able to fly to Switzerland. And we made, the plane had to stop in Berlin maybe. And when she got back on the plane, or when she was coming out, somebody, she was holding me, and somebody said, halt, you know, and she thought, oh my gosh, you know, she's gonna be found. And they wanted to take a picture because I was the youngest passenger. It was Lufthansa, you know. So she and I came to Switzerland. A couple of weeks later, my father and my sister came. And I think they didn't want to go together because, God forbid, if one of them got caught or whatever, you know. So then we were in Switzerland. That was my journey.
Can you, I know you were too little, but what did your parents or your sister, if she remember, could describe Kristallnacht in Germany, in Leipzig? How would you describe, how would your mother describe it,
or father? Well, quite frankly, they really didn't tell us that much about it, because for them, like I said, they, you know, we were little, and but, you know, Kristallnacht was that they, it was just all the Nazi thugs going around and breaking the store windows and writing on, you know, dirty Jew and so on and so forth. And they would beat up Jews, especially Jews with beards. And it was a horrible, horrible day. And it was condoned by the government. You know, that was the worst thing. So, but luckily, I mean, they weren't on the streets. I think Jews were afraid to go out that night in general, you know.
So nobody in your family was picked up during Kristallnacht?
No, and not during Kristallnacht, yeah.
Did you, I don't know if you would know this or not, but did you have passports to get into Switzerland? What kind of documents did you have?
We had visas. We had a visa to go to Switzerland. And my mother had a school friend living in Zurich. And that school friend was our sponsor. She sponsored us. So, and other than that, just had my father's Polish passport, you know. But now Switzerland was not that eager to take Jewish refugees in, you know. But because we had the visa already and because we had sponsors in Zurich, we were able to get in there. And well, like I said, you know, but we officially were refugees. So,
what was the sponsor's name?
The who? The sponsors? Oh, yeah, I wanted to talk to her. They were Rosel. She was called Rosel, and her husband Bunny, and their last name was Langer. And they were very instrumental in my life too, because they were another home, so to speak, for us as well. And she was a wonderful, wonderful cook, and she always tried to fatten me up. And I loved what she baked, beautiful things, and she had lovely pickles on her balcony, and I loved that, but I never got fat from it.
Is there anything else you'd like to say about the Langers in particular?
Well, they were good friends all the time we were there, and always hospitable. And she was a podiatrist. You know, she took care of people's feet. She had a business at home. And she also gave massages. And so she would take, like, if I had a cold, and she'd massage my head. And I had constant swollen glands all the time, but she would put cream on me and so on. So in a way, we were her children. She had lost a daughter, unfortunately, and she had one son, but I think we were her new daughters, her other daughters. And she was very caring. They were wonderful people.
So let's start with your experiences in Switzerland. You know, describe it. Describe where you live. You know, do what you can to tell us all about it.
Sure. Well, I guess I'll have to start. I mentioned that my mother was often ill with, I'm sure they were nerve-induced things, you know, ulcers and gallbladder problems and so on. So when we arrived in Germany, I was an infant, and she was sick. And you know, there was a place in Zurich called Inselhof, which was a place for unmarried women to go, and unmarried pregnant women to go and work a while and then give birth and stay as long as they had to stay. Anyway, they put me there, and I got very, very nice care. But I was, they had to put me into Inselhof because she couldn't cope with both of us, I guess. She had a 2.5, 3-year-old, and she had me as an infant. And I was put into Inselhof on and off until I was 5 years old. Then I couldn't really go anymore because I was in school. And I was being very well taken care of. It was run by Quakers, a group of wonderful, wonderful women. And I'll mention them again. And one woman especially, one nurse, Schwester Lotti, she became my surrogate grandmother in Switzerland. And we stayed friends, you know, until she died later on. But I'll probably talk more about her. When I couldn't go anymore into the infant section or the young children section, they had a group of, you know, where you, three or four, preschool, I guess, three, four, five. And Schwester Lotti, she was my sort of my main caretaker there. And so that's where I spent a lot of time. And my parents, again, in a letter that we found, my father wrote how sad they always were. They came to visit me, but they always had to leave. And I did not have that time of bonding, I guess, with them, you know, and it was a sad time for them. And I didn't know any difference. To me, that was just life, I guess, you know. But then as I grew older, I started Hebrew school when I was five. And we used to even walk alone. We could go to Hebrew school. It was in a synagogue not too far away. And I had to learn Hebrew, which was from right to left. And I was learning how to read from left to right. And I was a little confused. I was born left-handed and they changed me. So I had some problems with that, you know, distinguishing left and right and so on. Yeah, I'm talking about ancient history here, you know. This is a long time ago. And I didn't always enjoy school because in those days, you know, you got hit on your hand if you didn't use the right one and so on. But as I mentioned, my parents were Orthodox and I went to Hebrew school and I was brought up in an Orthodox home. And at that time when I started going to Hebrew school, I already, you know, I was walking alone sometimes, and there would be occasions when some kids would call me a dirty Jew on the street. So I always knew that I was an outsider, you know, that was not the best of times. But my parents, like I said, they sheltered us from all the ugly things happening, and we had a very comforting kind of family life. So we were lucky that way.
Now, let's go back to the school, in the home. How do you say it? Insula?
I'm sorry?
What was the name of the home that you were stayed
in? Inselhof. Yeah.
Inselhof. You mentioned the lady that, you know, you were especially fond of that took care of you. Was it called Schwester? What does that mean?
Yeah, Schwester is sister. So they were all called sisters. And she was Schwester Lotti. And they were nurses, really, you know. So, and Quaker was established, or, you know, religion or organization. I mean, it's very open, was very not very didactic. I think she had worked in the Red Cross at some point, and she sort of took a special interest, and she became a friend of the families, and she would invite me to her home in Bern, Bergdorf, a little town in Bern. And she lived in a small house, and she would invite me sometimes when I was a little older, you know, for weekends. And she had a beautiful garden. And I helped pick the raspberries. And so it was a nice relationship that we had.
Did you make any friends that you remember while you were there at the home?
Yeah. Well, children friends, I mean, at the not so much there, because after I was 5 years old, I wasn't allowed to go back there, you know, because then I was in public school and we were all exposed to too many things. They didn't want the children there. But I had a few friends from school or from the neighborhood, not too many. I don't think, you know, wasn't so much that you would go to people's houses or, again, you know, it was wartime. So everybody just sort of had enough for themselves. People were not that inviting. My sister had a friend from Hebrew school, somebody, she came from a pretty wealthy home, and she would visit her and spend time with her. And they actually, the Jewish community, you know, at Hanukkah holiday time, they would donate their clothing to us. So occasionally we got some velvet dresses or something really fancy. But I had maybe one or two girlfriends, and not really that much. I wasn't such a social time.
Is that a home still there today? Is the building still there? Or?
Well, when I went back in 2009, well, it was, yes, around 2018 maybe, they had moved. It was moved. And I went to the new place. It was a much bigger place. And I asked, and those people knew nothing about the people who used to run it, you know, because I had wanted to see if there was some kind of acknowledgement for them, which I thought they should have. So they just didn't know. And I think it was run by the city at that point. It was no longer organized and run by the Quakers. So, but the actual, I think the concept was still there. It was still a home that, you know, for unwed mothers, and but also a much bigger place and a hospital as well. So,
how would you describe where you lived in Zurich?
All right. Yeah, we lived in an apartment, a walk-up apartment, five flights up. We lived on the top floor. And we had heating was from one stove, a big potbelly stove, wasn't so big really, in the living room with pipes going to the kitchen and the bedroom. The toilet room had no heat, so it was really hard going to the bathroom sometimes in the cold winter. We had a kitchen with a little pantry off the kitchen, and we took baths in a metal sitting bathtub. You know, it was a family affair. But, you had to pour in all the water, and Rachel and I could take baths, and then obviously my parents would take it when they had some time. We had a kitchen. We had two bedrooms and a living room. And one of the bedrooms, during really tough times, we rented out to single people because it had a separate entrance, you know. So it was rented out, and we would have some renters that usually we didn't like them. Rachel and I, we didn't like them. One of them once took me to a band concert when I was about 4 or 5, and I ran home and I hid at home. I didn't want to be with him. So I don't know why I didn't like him, but that was another memory. But anyway, we lived on that floor. We were in charge. It had wooden steps, and we were in charge of polishing them every week. And I, that was my job, so I had to clean that. What else can I remember? The back, at the staircase had a little seating area and a window, and it looked out to a horse stable at that point. And again, I went back to look at the building. I didn't get inside, but everything, of course, has changed.
Do you remember the name of the street that the
street
apartment was on?
Yeah, that was 70, number 70, Zentralstraße. Zentralstraße, like C-E-N-T-R-A, Straße. That I remember.
So growing up in Switzerland, let's talk about, first of all, did you have a favorite toy that you remember that you had?
I didn't have any toys, really. I had one doll that Schwester Lotti, she gave me when I was, six, seven, maybe eight. She gave me an old doll that she had, and she had bought a new head for it. So that was my doll. And I would knit things or sew things for the doll and wrap it up. And I brought it with me to the United States. I don't know what happened to it, but I had it for a long time. But other than that, we really did not have toys, to play with. We, like I said, we made up a lot of games and kept ourselves busy.
So I'm just wondering, why did they change your left hand to the right hand? What was that about?
Because in those days, it was considered that it was, I think it came from the idea of that the left hand was a devil's hand, or it's just not used, I know when we were in Spain with my son, Bruce, they were a friend of mine, she had a maid. Bruce is left-handed too, and he was two at the time, and he would pick up his food, and she said, no, he can't use left, that's the devil's hand. So in my day, it was accepted to change people, I guess. Now, of course, they wouldn't do that, So but I managed. I'm ambidextrous, actually, so to some extent.
I was going to ask you, did it affect you in any way later on?
Well, it probably did. I mean, I kid about it sometimes. It's why I'm neurotic and why I'm whatever. But I do mostly everything with my right hand at this point. The only thing I do with my left hand is iron, and I don't do much ironing. So I'm not handicapped by it.
Where did you go to school in Switzerland?
Well, I'll start. I went to a lovely kindergarten. It was a few blocks from home. I could walk to kindergarten. And it was a one-story building. And in the back, they had a big play yard. And interestingly enough, it was my kindergarten teacher that I remember the most of all the other teachers that I had. I only had one or two others before I left. But her name was Frau Wolf, and her class I remember the best. It was just probably her care. She really cared again about me and trying to make me feel at home. And we also were friends for a while. She actually came to the States later on to look us up and see how we were doing. I remember the colors of each room had a different color so that you would know where to go when in kindergarten. When you came in, you had to take off your shoes, and there was a special place just in front of the classroom that you left all your clothing. And, we had kindergarten activities, painting and playing and It was a nice, that was a good experience for me. And then I went on to the other grades. And again, I got a little bit into the thing with getting hit on the hands for either, you know, not picking up the right with the right hand, or we had to learn the times table. And the teacher would go from each one. You had to know everything in sequence. And if you have the wrong one, you'd get hit on the hand too. So it was a slightly different idea of education. And I taught young children for 10 years. And of course, I remembered what not to do. Interestingly enough, I don't remember that much from that after kindergarten. I went through probably fourth grade, and I don't remember that much about school. I learned how to read, you know, and I was able to do my math, and I did everything, but I don't remember having a real kind of engagement with it. It was strange, you know.
So you didn't have a favorite subject that you liked or not?
Well, one of the things I went, we had a lovely pediatrician who we would go to and see every few months. And she also always worked, you know, you have to gain some weight, you have to get fatter, blah, blah, blah. But when we, on the visits, she always gave me a pencil and paper and I was able to draw. So, and she always commented, you know, how nice that was. I drew garden houses, whatever. And that was probably the beginning of when I really wanted to do some art. And I had favorite things. In first grade, one thing I remember, we had to learn how to knit. And I enjoyed that. I think I enjoyed working with my hands. I enjoyed creative things always. But I was good in math and the other things too.
Do you remember any friends you may have made in the public school?
I don't think I made a lot of friends. In school, I'm sure, you know, in the school, but like I say, you know, it wasn't like you had anybody come over to your house. Also, you know, we were kosher. I couldn't really eat anybody's house, so I wouldn't go to anybody's house. So it wasn't any real close-knit. My social life was around the family and adult friends, other people.
What was the Jewish life like in Zurich?
In Zurich? Like I said, I was in Hebrew school, and my parents went to synagogue. I don't remember going that much to a synagogue in Switzerland. I think my father probably went, but we as children, we didn't go much. But we had a very Jewish, my mother, we kept the Sabbath and we lit the candles. And but we did it more as outsiders, you know, just trying to keep our culture within ourselves. It wasn't so much, we weren't part of really big Jewish organizations or anything. But we had all the holidays and had said our prayers every night. And it was, that was a comforting part of life, you know, so.
Did you have a favorite Jewish holiday that you remember celebrating while you were in Zurich?
Yeah, probably Passover was one of the nicest ones. And because it, you know, you had a change, you only ate the matzah and it was spring. It was usually a time when you got a new pair of shoes, maybe, and then maybe a new dress. And so that was a nice holiday. And Sukkot, the festival of the huts, that was nice too. And like I said, you know, mostly we celebrated it within our family. I had one friend, she lived across the street, a little girl, Claire Lee. She came to us on the Sabbath when we weren't allowed to light the fire. She came and she did the lighting of the stove for us so that we had warmth on a Sabbath, you know. But we, like I said, it's not as though we shared each other's families or, you know, wasn't such a close-knit thing.
Who led the Seder and who came to the Seder? Anybody outside of your immediate family?
There was no one. We had no family, really, you know, and we usually had it at home. And for many years, I was the youngest, so I would ask the questions, and my father would, of course, lead the Seder. Eventually, my brother was the youngest, so he was. But in Switzerland, there was really nobody that we could share it with, you know. And even our friends, the Lungers, I don't think they were quite as orthodox as we were, you know, so you couldn't have it in another person's house because you don't know how kosher it was and so on and so forth, you know. So in that way, it was a limited thing.
Do you remember what Shabbat was like at your house and maybe some dishes that your mother cooked for Shabbat? Would you describe it?
Shabbat was very important. She even made challah a lot of times. My mother, you know, food was rationed and you had to have the ration tickets, and there was no kosher meat in Switzerland during the war. You could only get chickens and you could get fish. So my mother would buy one chicken for the week. Friday night, it was chicken soup. And Saturday on Shabbos, you got the cooked chicken that was in the soup, the boiled chicken. And she kept for Sunday, she kept some fillets from the breast. And we had chicken fillets, breaded. That was Sunday. And then the rest of the week, whatever was left over, you know. But my mother was a wonderful baker. She made great cakes for Shabbos. And sometimes we had some fish. She would make the filter fish. So, yes, we enjoyed that. And Shabbos was a time of staying at home and reading and taking a walk and doing, you know, things that you do on a Shabbos, which is mostly rest.
What was your favorite food that your mother cooked for you?
Well, number one, I have to say, it's chocolate pudding and whipped cream. That was, I think, what I lived on. That was my favorite. I liked other things, but I ate so little of it, so... I liked her chicken. I liked most of her food. It's not that she wasn't a good cook. I lived on the cream. You know, in those days, you got your milk and you had to boil it, and the cream would come to the top, and I would get that. And that's probably the big thing that kept me going. I loved milk and cheese and all of that, and everything else was delicious. I just ate a tiny bit.
We're going to take a break right now, and then we'll continue, okay?
All right. Do I need to clap?
No, only when we start. We're going to stop now. Okay.
Okay. So you'll tell me when you want me to back.
Sure will. Okay. So Sonja, getting back to where we left off, I want to go back to what did your father do and your mother do as far as jobs in Switzerland? What happened to them while you were in Zurich?
Yeah, I wanted to mention that there were other Jewish immigrants in Zurich, and they formed a cooperative. It was called the Flickstube. They formed a cooperative where they took in mending and laundry and all kinds of services and was a cooperative so that everybody earned a little bit of money through that. And it was run by the immigrants, and they even had a little newsletter among themselves, and they had a social life with each other, you know, at the Flickstube there. And occasionally my father would take me, and I could see what they do and how they work. And I was very, very impressed. I always loved colors, I guess. And they had like a wonderful display of all the color threads that they used. And I began to play with them, you know. But that was the only bit of earnings that my father had at that point. Before that, when we came to Switzerland, he was actually interred into a labor camp in Switzerland. He had to work on roads, and they got paid, you know, minimal. I mean, nothing practically. It was slave labor. But he was then dismissed. I think he got sick at some point, and they dismissed him. Other than that, during the war, he couldn't have any jobs. He wasn't allowed to work because the Swiss were afraid that the immigrants would take away jobs from them.
Why did they send him to a labor camp? Was it because of being Jewish, or what was the reason?
Yeah, because he was an immigrant and because he was Jewish, and they felt that that's, you know, they might as well make use of them, and that he earned some money. It was very, very little, but they paid him something.
Did he ever describe the conditions when he was in the labor camp? And for how long was he there?
For that, it was probably just a matter of months. And they actually did let them go home sometimes, you know, for weekends. I mean, as much as he talked about it, conditions weren't very great. And one friend of his actually... he needed some medical help, and the guard or the head person didn't follow through, and he became very sick and he died, you know. So you had a certain sadism for power over people, and the usual with that kind of a situation, you know, was not ideal. But other than that, he didn't describe much, so.
Did your... parents have any communications with anybody back in Germany during this time in Switzerland?
My father wrote a lot of letters to trying to communicate. None of his family was left in Germany. My mother's family, her brothers, they left quite late, but they managed to escape to England. And so they just had to deal with the terrors in England, not because they were Jews, because of the World War. One brother and my mother's parents escaped to Belgium, and they were arrested at that point. Well, the parents were arrested, and my uncle escaped somehow over the roofs, and he escaped. But my grandparents were arrested, but it was just a few weeks before liberation in Belgium. But so my grandfather survived. My grandmother got sick, but she died in England also. So they managed to end up in England. But my father wrote a lot of letters to family in England, and he tried to communicate. Actually, one sister of his, Frieda, who had a son my sister's age, just about the same, she and her husband in 38, when we left for Switzerland, they went to France, thinking that that would be a haven. And as soon as Hitler came into France, things got bad. And my parents, actually, they wrote to her, send us Abi, the son, to save at least Abi, you know, to save him, because the Quakers at Inselhof were saving children. That was one of the things they were involved in. And they could have helped us bring him to us, you know, to save him. And she said she can't part with him, which, of course, I understood, you know, everybody. And they were arrested and sent to Auschwitz, and they all died there. So that was, you know, heartbreaking. And but my sister found a lot of letters from her and how desperate they were. And my parents tried to send them tea or coffee or something, because at some point they had nothing. And it didn't always get there, because in those, I mean, you know, communications was very precarious, whether letters got opened and things, packages were raided and so on. So that was one of her sisters. Another sister of his came to the States in 36. She married an American. She didn't marry an American, but they came to America, became Americans. So of all his siblings, she was one who survived. And his other brothers, he had three sisters and four brothers. And all the other two sisters died in Auschwitz. And four brothers, they also were arrested and died in Auschwitz. And only, and several of his nephews and nieces were, you know, killed also. One niece, she went to England with a Kindertransport. I don't know, have you heard of that? She was 16 at the time, and she got to England, and her parents and a little brother, they perished. But in England, she was with a family that sort of treated her like a maid. And when she was of age, she joined the English army, and she did very well in there. But needless to say, you know, these people had such trauma that she came to the States as a young woman, and she lived with us for a while. But she was very, very introverted and very quiet, and I mean, people could not talk, you know. And my sister and I, we never asked questions, because I knew how painful all this was for my father, especially, you know. So that's why I mentioned he was always sad. He didn't really know what was happening to his family until after the war, when a nephew of his had two cousins who survived Auschwitz. One of them was already on the death heap, and the other one hid with him on the death heap. And finally they were, you know, liberated and went through all the difficulties then. But he wrote to my father, told him what had happened to hit my father's father and so on. And because he was one of the cousins, he was the last one in town in Tarnów before they cleaned them all out. And basically they were like 14 and 17 when they were put into Auschwitz. And they were two strapping boys, luckily, and they survived, you know. They got jobs in the camps and worked and so. But they lost parents and a younger and another brother. So I didn't realize the enormity of my father's loss, you know. And until I went to Germany for the Stolperstein program, where they were all being honored and remembered. So, and yet we knew all the time that he was suffering. And one of the reasons he suffered so much about it was because he always felt guilty that he could only save his own family and not the rest, you know. So it's like, it's a syndrome. I'm sure you heard this before many times. And so that was a sad thing. But I don't know if do you want to ask.
So after hearing what you said, how did that affect you throughout your years, your father's and your mother's, but their experiences? How did that affect you?
Well, I think it's made me a serious person too, you know. It affected me in terms of my, at some point, I'm not a observant person in terms of, you know, religion, in terms of, what should I say, organized religion. I'm a spiritual person, but I don't get it from religion or organized religion. I love nature. That's where I find my spiritual fulfillments. I think both my sister and I, she even more was, she's more serious because she, being the oldest, was very often imposed upon for many responsibilities with me and my brother. And yeah, I think it made me kind of a serious person. And while I'm an optimistic person, I always feel there's a certain precarious quality about life, and you always have to watch and be careful and not forget things, you know. And I suppose in some ways I just accepted the fact that I would always feel maybe as an outsider, even though, I mean, this country has given me so much, and I love this country. But even in this country, we have to watch, you know. So that's, and my first trip to Israel, I think I cried because I felt the first time that I was sort of home, you know. And yet, I don't know if I can live in Israel either. It has certain theocratic tendencies in some ways, you know. But that's another issue. So, yeah, in effect, you know, I guess I wanted to do things that were beneficial and helpful, and I enjoyed teaching and brought my two boys up with hopefully respect for nature and people and ethical life and so on, you know. So.
So before, is there anything else you'd like to say about your time in Switzerland? Any, what memories stand out to you the most while you were there?
I guess my relationship with people that I loved in Switzerland, and that was the hardest thing about leaving. Other than that, there was not much in Switzerland that engaged me or that I really cared about, you know. But the people who I loved, like Lotti and the Longers and so on, when we were leaving, that was the hardest to leave. And Lotti especially, we wrote letters for years and years, and she said to me when we were leaving, she said, just remember, we're always looking at the same moon. And that gave me comfort too, you know. So my in some ways, my real life and the best part of my life started when we came to the States. There's no doubt about that, you know. And that was in 48. We were on the quota for 3 years, for the Polish quota. And like I say, America has given me and my family tremendous gifts, you know.
So your parents decided not to stay permanently in Switzerland. What made them want to go to America?
Well, the choice for them was either America or Australia. And it was a matter of who was able to, you know, where we were able to go first. So, and it was America. And in Switzerland, we would never have become citizens. I mean, we would always be outsiders. I think the only way you could buy yourself in, if you had money and so on, but becoming a citizen there was you know, almost an impossibility. Here, my and my father already had his sister here and brother-in-law, and then his nephews, the ones who survived from Auschwitz, they came here too. And his sister, who was living here, is the one who sent the affidavit for and the visas and sponsored us here. So it was just a good decision that way.
Is there anything else you'd like to say about your time in Switzerland before we go on?
No, I think I've sort of covered. I mean, it was a long time. Like I say, I also have forgotten a lot about Switzerland. I wiped out a certain part of my life.
So how would you describe the Swiss and the way they treated the Jews while you were there? I mean, I know you were young, but how would you describe, what was their attitude towards Jews?
Well, like I said, I think they were the most afraid of taking, you know, other immigrants, especially Jews. There was prejudice against Jews, but it was based on, you know, the old wives' tales, the Jews killed Christ and, you know, all of that stuff. But the other thing I think was the economic. They were afraid that they would come and take jobs away from the Swiss. And they're not, well, they turned away a whole boat. I think there's a whole boat, a movie of that too, a story. A boat of Jews that had to go back to Germany, and they were not hospitable, you know, and I think it was probably also fear of foreigners in general and their way of life. I mean, it's a small country. They tended to be rather provincial. Actually, Lotte, who lived in this tiny little town, she always made fun of those people, how provincial they were, you know. And, you know, the joke is that by the time a plane takes off, it's already out of Switzerland. So it's a real small country that they have to defend.
Do you remember anything at all about the day that you left Switzerland? Anything?
Yes, I do. I do. We were told we were going to go to New York, and one friend showed us a map once, and she showed us this big green area in the middle of New York, which was Central Park, you know. So I had visions of going to this beautiful green city, you know. But anyway, we left by train. We left Zurich. It was evening. And Lotte came to the train station, and we waved goodbye. And I felt, you know, there was a certain amount of excitement about going to a new place, a certain amount of fear. You don't know what's going to be. And we left on a train. We went to France, and we crossed the channel. And the channel is pretty rough most of the time. And I remember most people being at the edge of the ship, being seasick. But I always loved the water, you know, so I loved going across. And then we left on a boat called Batory, which before we were on that boat, it was a luxury liner. And then during the war, it was used as a moving troops around, and became a military ship for a while. It was a small boat, and we left there. It was July, and we were on the ocean for a week. And I remember going swimming in the pool, and it was rough, and the pool would get deep, and then it wouldn't, you know. So it was, I enjoyed it. Like I say, I love the water. And when we got to New York, we got there a day early, I think, and they couldn't let us dock yet, you know. But I remember the moment everybody came out to look at the Statue of Liberty. And it was emotional. So, like I say, life began again. And the next day when we got off the ship, my two cousins were there to meet us, the ones that had survived. And then it was just a matter of some friends up in Washington Heights, they let us stay until we could find an apartment and so on. So we moved to Jackson Heights. That's where I spent the next 10 years, more or less.
So you settled in, so you settled in Jackson Heights. Tell me about your time there.
Well, my parents found a nice apartment. We were five at that point, and we had two bedrooms. My brother got a little niche off the kitchen to sleep in. And I went to public school, entered public school. And Jackson Heights at that point was a nice neighborhood, not built up the way it is now. I don't know if you know that neighborhood at all. You know, it's extremely diverse at this point. When we moved in, it had just been, it used to be restricted. They wouldn't allow Jews, but it was just opened to Jews as well. And I went to Hebrew school again, to a nearby synagogue. And my very first friend, Myra Herbst, she was my age, she is still, she's my age. And she was a Polish from Poland. And she and her mother were hidden up in a hayloft for 2 years on somebody's farm. And her father had been killed. He was a poet and intellectual, and he had already been killed. So it was strange. She, you know, I met her in Hebrew school, and she became my best friend. And my sister, her best friend lived across from us, and she had gone from Vienna to China on foot a lot. She was also a little child, and they went on foot. So it was strange that we happened to get close to people that had the same background, more or less. I mean, we were much more fortunate than, you know, other people. But I lived in that neighborhood, and I went to high school in the city. I went to High School of Music and Art. So I had a big subway trip in, and then subway trip to Hebrew school. So I spent a lot of hours on the subway. But I had a marvelous education. New York at that point had a wonderful educational system, you know. And then for college, I went to Cooper Union Art School, and eventually that's where I met my husband. So, and we have been together, raised two wonderful sons, and have wonderful grandchildren, and I am so fortunate to be here. Otherwise, if we hadn't gotten out of that railroad station, I would not be. So
how would you describe your life in the, your adjustment, I'm sorry, in the United States? When you first got there, what was it like to adjust?
Yeah, at first it was somewhat difficult because we spoke minimal amount of English, you know. And when I first went to school, public school, they put me into second grade, even though I had been probably in fourth grade. And they said, you know, just sit and learn English, basically. So eventually I could participate. And actually, Rachel and I, we learned English pretty quickly. You do when you're with children, and you have to. And my parents made a real effort to speak to us in English all the time, you know. I obviously still speak German, and not terribly fluent. Well, not terribly fluent. My husband always says it's a 10-year-old vocabulary. But it took a while, but the adjustment was not that bad. It was really pretty good. So, and you know, I was in school. There were more. We did have a Jewish community a little bit in Jackson Heights, and so there was a little bit more of an integration there. So,
did you experience any anti-Semitism in the United States when you first arrived, or you know, in the years?
Yeah. Not nothing overt. I mean, I'm sure it was around, you know, but nothing overt at that time. I felt, you know, America was a land of many people, so that's what we came to.
Which synagogue did you go to? You mentioned you went to Hebrew school. Were you still Orthodox at this point?
My family was, and I was to some extent, but as I got older, I was less and less, and by the time, there was a synagogue, I don't remember, well, there was a Young Israel, which is a branch, they're all over, you know. My father organized one in Jackson Heights after a while, and but that wasn't, I went to Hebrew school and one that was a little further away. But as I sort of was finishing high school, going into college, I couldn't feel that I could be observant or, you know, be happy with organized religion anymore. So I always say out of three of us, my brother is well done. He's Orthodox. My sister is medium rare. She's still Orthodox, and I'm rare. So I've given it. But I, you know, the Jewish culture is very much part of me, and I've tried to instill that into my children and grandchildren. So,
just to go back to the ship a minute bit that you came to America on, were there other refugees on the ship that you might have befriended, or any of the children on the ship?
Not really. Again, we didn't socialize much because, again, we had to, you know, we had the dietary restrictions, and there wasn't that much. I don't remember making much contact with a lot of other people. My parents may have had more, but we were little. You know, I remember going to see one movie, which I didn't understand, of course. But there wasn't that much interaction that I can remember. I have a picture, which I can show you later, of us at the table on the boat.
Okay. Anything else that you would like to talk about in your youth in Jackson Heights?
No, I think I've mentioned most of it. I have watched Jackson Heights sort of evolve into this new, it's almost a little city, a little country of its own, you know. But I left it then for San Francisco. I was 21 when I left, so I really only lived there 11 years. My mother stayed there for many years. She stayed there until she died. So I went back to visit, of course, to see her. And she ended up having lived there about 46 years, yeah, which is a long time.
What happened? Tell me about your parents. Like, what happened with them when they came to America?
With the parents? Yeah, like I mentioned, my mother started her own business to work at home as a seamstress. And we sometimes had to go around to apartment houses and put a card underneath the door to advertise her business, you know. And that was like always kind of embarrassing, but we did it. And I helped her sometimes. I enjoyed sewing and also... And my father, he was in business. He was a broker, fur broker. So he was busy, and he traveled some to go, you know, sometimes to buy furs and then travel to meet with customers and so on. So they were busy.
And how did they die? When
My father died when he was 70 in 1976. And he had a stroke. He was in a coma for a few days, and he actually passed out. It was on the high holiday of Yom Kippur in the synagogue. He passed out and never regained consciousness, so he died then. 70 nowadays, that's considered fairly young, I guess, but my mother lived to be, she was close to 87, and she had some heart problems, and eventually she was in the hospital when she died, but she was living on her own until then, you know. Her mind was always sharp, and she still played her piano, and she was still a very optimistic person. So it was nice to be with her when she was there.
How did you meet your husband and when?
Well, I had gone to Cooper Union. I was a year ahead of him. And when I graduated, they had a beautiful campus. It was called Green Camp. The school owned this campus. And they allowed us students to have weekend trips to this camp. And after I graduated, I was, they called it the counselor. You know, I would help groups get adjusted and find everything and so on. And his class came to on the trip, and a friend, somebody we knew both a mutual friend, introduced us. And we spent a lot of time at the fireplace talking, and he asked me for my number and got to know each other. So, and that was in 1960. And it turned out that then he was an art student too. And he had also applied to the same school in San Francisco that I had applied to for our BFAs. And we got to know each other during the summer. And then in August, we went out to California together. And California, we decided to get married, because in those days, you got married. You didn't live together. So we came back in December and we got married. So it was all 1 year. So, and so it's been 60 years that
Where did you go to school in California?
San Francisco Art Institute, up on the hill, Chestnut Hill, right? And it was actually in public school. I had a very lovely art teacher in public school, and I kept drawing, and she helped me make a portfolio because to get into music and art, you had to bring a portfolio and you had to take a test and so on. So she was very supportive. Another teacher told me at the time, don't bother applying to music and art because you don't speak English well enough. But I didn't listen to her. So it did apply, and I was drawing a lot in public school, fifth and sixth grade, you know. And then at music and art, I took some at art, and I pursued it.
Did your experiences that you had influence your art in any way, in your drawing?
To some extent, maybe at first when I was drawing, I was always drawing idyllic scenes, you know, people in beautiful costumes or dancers or skaters or whether that was just wishful thinking or not, you know. But my art, well, sometimes my self-portraits maybe, or portraits, they may look sad, you know. I as a teenager, I mean, everybody gets through difficult times, right? So, but I don't think it had any special. I mean, it's not that my art is dark or, you know, I don't think I became cynical. If anything, I'm still optimistic. I hope.
So you went out to San Francisco, and how long were you there, and where did you go?
We were there for about I went out in August, and we came back the following September with a little baby. I gave birth in San Francisco. Bruce was born in San Francisco. So.
And where did you go to when you came back?
We went, we had no money, we had no jobs, we had nothing. But we had a temporary apartment in the Bronx, and I hated the Bronx. And then we found an apartment in Brooklyn. And I had worked for a publishing company before I left for San Francisco. I got some freelance work from them. And in 1963, Richard got a Fulbright to Spain for his art. So we went to Spain for about 9 months, or almost a year, I guess, with a baby, 2-year-old. Was nice. And so we've been in different places.
What was that like to go back to Europe, to Spain? Did you want to go back to Leipzig, or, you know, when you were there? What was it like being in Spain?
Yeah, it was nice being in Spain, because we loved the whole idea of being in Spain, you know. And we, on the way back, we thought we would want to go to Munich, to the big museum there. And we did. We were there in Munich for a couple of days, and I was not comfortable, because that was not that long after the war. You know, we went to an eatery, and it sounded just like the old putsch thing, and I was not comfortable. When I went back for the Stolperstein in Berlin, it's now totally different. You know, it's a young city, it's an open city, and Germany, they're very, very conscious of acknowledging what happened and not to be anti-Semitic, you know. So,
you mentioned earlier you were going to talk about some letters that later found. Could you address that now?
Yeah, well, the letters that we found after my parents, we were cleaning out the apartment, you know. It was a whole different idea about my father, because he was so ebullient about his daughters. I mean, which he never showed in real life, you know. He was much more sedate, much more. But he would write about how wonderful his little babies were, the girls, and Rachel, she talked very early, and she was, and if they didn't, when they had to put me into Inselhof, he said if they didn't have Rachel, they'd have nothing, you know, because she keeps them happy and so on. So it was very interesting, because there were things in the letters that he would never have expressed in real life. I mean, we always knew how much that he loved us, you know, but he would never really lavish us in praise or for anything, you know. So it was always a little bit. But
what did you do with the letters? Do you still have them? What have you done with them?
Rachel, my sister, has them. She used them. She has quotes from them in her memoir. So you're going to interview her, I think. So she'll tell you. She has them, and she spent hours and hours translating all of that. She'll give you a lot more than I can.
So you ended up back in Brooklyn, and then where did you go from there?
When we came back from Spain, we came back to Brooklyn. We lived in Brooklyn for a while, and I started, I had my second child in Brooklyn, Aaron, and when he was 3, I decided I needed to get out of the house, and we needed to separate. I was loving him to death, you know. He was so cute. So I got a job as an assistant in a kindergarten, local kindergarten, and I put him into preschool. And then the kindergarten teacher became pregnant, and they asked me if I would take over, if I would become teacher. And I actually loved it, you know. So I had to take some courses, and I started teaching kindergarten. And then we moved to Connecticut, to Bethlehem, with the kids. And I got a job there teaching in lower school, in a private school, first grade. And there I taught for about 10 years, and taught first grade and third grades. And I became head of the lower school for a while, so until I was let go at some point, because we got somebody who I couldn't agree with philosophically about education. So, and then Richard and I started our own business. So,
what type of business was that?
We did a design business, designing books, and we did projects with publishers, you know. And then we sold our ideas to publishers, and we did packaging for publishers. And then we started our own imprint. So we had our own publishing company. And I'll show you just briefly. We did a series on the Holocaust for middle school, lower school, middle school, and high school, I guess, because it was mandated in New York to teach. Actually all over, I think, to teach the Holocaust. But anyway, so maybe I'll show you just a few pictures? Or are we not up to that?
I've got a few more things to ask you.
Okay.
Yeah, so what made you move to Connecticut?
We wanted to have a little land around us. We bought this unfinished little garage, and we fixed it up into a little house. We had about 5.5 acres, and we wanted to have a garden. We had a quarter acre garden to grow vegetables, our own. We were one of the early people doing gardening organically, organic garden. And then we also raised some animals, so the kids got to see how food is grown. And it was okay. I mean, I enjoyed it. And I taught Bethlehem's tiny town. I taught in Waterbury, so both kids went to school where I was teaching. So that worked nicely. We had the same vacations, you know. And Richard had a job. He had a pretty long drive in Middletown. But we just loved the land, and we loved projects. So we always did projects.
And then after Bethlehem, where did you go?
When both kids were sort of out of the house, we moved to New Haven. And we had a lovely house with upstairs, a third floor, where we had our studio at that time. And then as we grew and needed more space, we rented office space in New Haven. But that's where we lived for another 16 years. And then lots of snow shoveling. And then we came out to, we sold our business. And Bruce was part of the sale. He was our editor. Richard was art director of our business. This was for our own publishing company, you know, and I was production manager and so on. So Bruce came with the new company that bought us and was out here in California, in San Diego. So we decided to move out. And he had the grandchildren, so it was a no-brainer, you know. And my younger son had already come out to California in 1990. So we were all out here, and no more snow shoveling, which big plus.
How many grandchildren do you have?
I now have three. Yeah, two from Bruce, and I have a little, they're grown up. They're 27 and 25. And I have a little two-year-old from my other son. So, but they're in Hawaii. So, but I get cute little videos from them. So I'm very fortunate.
Was your husband a survivor?
No. My husband was born and bred in Brooklyn. He obviously, he's my age. He's a little younger, but he went through the war. Not directly, but they were always aware of it as well, you know. But he lived in Brooklyn, and it was that's a much more integrated and, you know, community. I think he didn't feel any real discomfort being there, you know.
You mentioned a bit earlier, when did you go back to Germany? You want to talk about that
there? And I have some pictures too from that. Yeah, in 2017, my sister Rachel and her husband and her son, Stephen, we went for the Stolperstein program, which I mentioned, I think.
Could you explain that? How do you spell that first of all?
Okay, Stolperstein, and I don't know if it has an E, if it's plural, Stolpersteine or Stolperstein. I think Stolpersteine probably, which means really sort of cobblestones. You know, that's what it means, little cobblestones. And a gentleman by the name of Gunter Demming, who is not Jewish himself, but he started this program, I think, 20 years ago. And he felt that he quoted from the, I don't know if it's Torah or the Chumash or whatever, but that you remember people through their names. That's how you remember. So he sets stones in front of the houses where people lived in Leipzig. I mean, that's where we went to specifically. On the first trip, Rachel and I, we went for our grandparents, my father's parents. We went to their house where they lived, and they set the two stones for them. And then in 19, I went again with my granddaughter and Rachel's son and her granddaughter and a grandson. So the next generation, we went for my father's brothers and sisters who were killed and my cousins that were killed. So we did, it's a lovely ceremony. Actually, at Rachel's, we had somebody even come and play the flute, and had little music, and you could talk about the people. The trip that I went on was run by my cousin, who was the son of the two survivors. I mean, of one of the survivors from Auschwitz. He's the son, and his sister came, and he sort of organized the whole thing. I had two second cousins coming from Israel for my cousin who went to England, her daughters, you know. So it was a lovely reunion. It was very emotional because, as I may have mentioned, it was only as an adult that I realized the enormity of the loss that my father experienced, you know. And that's when I could understand his deep, deep hurt. So, but the ceremony, Richard Demming organized it in such a way that he involved high school students. They were responsible to research the families that were being honored. And so it was a very educational program as well, which the Germans, they are very, very conscious of that.
How did you find this
program?
Yeah.
You know, I found out somehow Rachel's son researched. I don't know exactly how he found out, but he did the research for it. And I just found out because whatever he found out, you know, I was part of the organization that he got together. But I guess you can, at this point you can look it up, you know, and Google it, and it'll tell you all about it. And I have a couple of pictures that I blew up from them too. So the big thing was the people also, in some cases, of course, the houses weren't there anymore, you know, so they just laid the stones wherever they could. But in my case, my father's name and mother's name, Rachel's name, my name, and that's in front of the house where I was born. So it's just a nice way to remember.
Did you actually meet the artist? Did you meet him?
Yes.
What was he like?
The gentleman.
Do you know what motivated him? Did he ever talk about it or?
Yeah, I think he felt very important. He felt it was very important for people to remember the people who lived there and were expelled, you know, from where they lived, and people that are living there now. They always invited the people who lived there now to come and see the ceremony, you know, and some people did come. And he felt very strongly that it should not only be known by the people who had to leave, but if it's in the street, it's a daily reminder. You see this one named, you know, and I think it even says, here lived so-and-so. Each plaque says, you know, here. And it tells us when they left and what happened to them, whether they escaped or whether they were murdered or whether they were in Auschwitz and so on. That was all through the research that the students did. So they.
Is it just in Leipzig or is it all over? Do you know?
He's done it in many different places, even I think in some places in Poland and other. In some cities in Germany, they didn't want him to do it. But it's, I think, in Leipzig, and I think Berlin was all right, and I don't know all the cities, but he has gone in other countries, maybe even in Italy or wherever, but he's done it for, you know, many thousands of people already, so.
So let me ask you a philosophical question. What's your attitude towards Germany and the Germans today?
Well, you know, when some relatives heard, not so much my relatives, but my cousin's relatives heard that we were going to Germany for the Stolperstein, they were irate. How could you go back there and spend money and terrible, blah, blah, blah. But the truth of the matter is we do have to move on as people. And Germany, like I said, I felt very comfortable now being in Germany. I did not feel, you know, I did not get a feeling of that they didn't want us there. And of course, we were tourists too, you know. But they are much more accepting, and they're people much more of today. You know, you can't keep holding this grudge forever. You have to kind of accept what happened and take the responsibility, which they are. And basically it's three generations afterwards already, you know. So how can you keep on feeling real anger at this? But we must remember. I'm not, you know, it's absolutely necessary to remember.
What advice would you like to give to your children, your grandchildren, and future generations? Because people are going to be watching this.
What after what you experienced being a refugee, what advice would you like to give?
Well, my advice, and I think I'm giving this to my grandchildren especially, is to enjoy what they have, to learn as much as you can, and I definitely learn about history, because I think we've neglected that so badly that many people don't know the history. They say it's not relevant anymore, but it is in terms of learning from history. That's what history should be there for. And my advice is to, of course, learn about the past, but live towards the future and be optimistic and work as hard as you can to make it a better world. And never, never take anything for granted. You know, we cannot ever think, well, you know, we live in America and everything is hunky-dory. It seems we always need to be vigilant and keep fighting for what we think is fair and democratic and wonderful about this country. So that's the best I can do, I hope.
I'm wondering, since we're living through this pandemic now and what's going on, do you see any, I don't know, any similarities or anything that you'd like to bring up after this experience of the past year?
Well, I see a lot of different things. One of the things, I think a lot of creativity has come out of it. People have had to do certain things in different ways. You had to rethink. I have a great deal of faith in the young people because they have so much at stake now. You know, there's so much to work with. And I think they're engaged as opposed to being apathetic at this point in terms of justice, in terms of the ecology, in terms of everything. The one scary thing about what has come out, there has been scapegoating in the pandemic. You know, either it's the Chinese or the Japanese or the Jews causing this whole scapegoating. This is something that we always have to be vigilant about. And that's kind of a scary thing. People always have to find somebody to blame, you know, about what's happening. So there are positive things. And probably a lot of creativity, Zoom-wise, you know, people have given concerts and people have reunited, it seems, over. So that's been a lot of good stuff, too.
Is there anything else that you would like to say? Anything that you forgot or left out or anything? Just take a minute to think for a minute. If there's anything...
If I have a few moments to show some pictures, that'll fill in whatever else there might be.
Is there anything else that you feel you may fill in when you do the pictures? Okay. You
could do that. Yeah, it might. I'll just show you.
So I want to thank you for the interview part, and we'll do your pictures now. I think we covered everything, but as we do the pictures, if you have anything more to say.
Yeah, I probably will. So this is one picture. I'm the baby, my father and mother in Inselhof. This was when I was in 1939. I was not quite a year old. But those are my parents. This one has a number of pictures, this page, and shows me at about 2, and then my sister, Rachel, myself, in those dresses that my mother made, and our newly born brother, fairly newly. Can you see it?
Yes, now I can. Yep.
Let's see. This is a book my son put together. Okay, won't take up that much time. Just here actually is the one on this page with my brother. And remember I told you about Lotti? She took me to her place, and she had this wonderful dog, Alex, that I was partially afraid of, but I finally petted him. And the others won't go into it. And I wanted to show you, let's see, go to picture of my mother and my sister, Rachel. This was taken about 5 or 6 years before my mother died. Now this one is a picture of my sister and myself in 17 in front of the house that I was born. It's number 11. That's in Leipzig. 17. And then this is the gentleman who does the work. One, he has a helper, but you can see he takes out cobblestones and then puts in the plaques. That's Gunter Demming. And this was, these are the cobblestones, I mean the new plaques that are put down in front of the house. It has art. This was for my parents and for Rachel and me. And this was on the trip. The person on my left was my granddaughter. And the gentleman all the way on the left is Rachel's son.
Lovely.
And the one on all the way on your right is her grandson, and then the granddaughter Ronnie in between Rafi and me.
That's in front of the camera for
sure. Okay. Did you get that?
Yes, I got it. Okay. Thank you.
Let's see. I'll show you something. What else do I have? Yeah, I wanted to show you. This is a cover of one of the books in our series that we did. And this, I'm sure, is in one of the archives at this point. Because my husband and son, we work closely with the Holocaust Museum in Washington, D.C. So, did you get that, Zach? I'm sorry.
Sonja, did you write a book at all?
I did, yes.
Do you have that to show? And can you just tell briefly what the book is?
I do. Can I get up a second to get it?
Oh, sure. Yeah.
I think I have.
Oh, how lovely. What is it about? Just tell, show it to the camera.
Yeah, I will. The Big Promise. And it's about gardening. I wrote it so that hopefully to inspire children to go out into nature. And I did the illustrations. And I'll just go to one or two things. I made a little story about a spoiled prince who didn't want to do anything, and finally, a gardener came to teach him everything he needed to know about life and about how to... Did you get that, Zach? If you want to... One, I don't know.
Got it?
Yeah, I won't go through the whole thing. But anyway, you learn about work when you garden. He learned how to read because he had to find out everything about seeds. He learned about loss because sometimes rabbits would come and eat some of the vegetables. And he learned about charity because he gave food away when they had too much at the palace. And he learned also how to store seeds. And anyway, after he became king, the whole kingdom had gardens. So I'm sorry, it's a big book here. But anyway, I'm going backwards. They had big festivals, and all the, I'm going backwards now. No, that's bad. So that was a book that I wrote a couple of years ago. I still have some left. I self-published. Bruce helped me put it together. And I spoke to gardening clubs, and I had book signing parties and so on, you know. So that was
very, very nice. Beautiful. Do you have a painting that you'd like to share with us that you did? Something that might be related to your story, if you have it. I don't know. You know.
Well, I'd have to get up again. Is that all right? I mean, I just have a few around that I could take.
So Zach, she needs to just get a painting. Is it something that's on the wall? It could, but you have to do it in front of the camera, right, Zach?
Yeah. Okay. I also do prints, but I won't do everything. Well, let me see. I do a lot of landscapes.
Beautiful.
I like nature. And I don't know if I can get this front of the camera, the whole thing. Can you see it this way?
Let's sit down and just hold it kind of on your lap. I'll be able to see it.
Oh, okay. So, okay. Like this?
Yeah, a little higher, and then I can see the whole thing. Perfect. Looks great.
Sonja, do you have a picture of Lottie?
Yes, I do.
Maybe on. That would be a good one to show.
Yep. I think I have that in here. Let me see. Bruce put this book together for me for my 70th birthday.
How lovely. What a lovely.
Yeah. This is, Lottie came to visit us when we were in Spain. She came to visit us from Switzerland. So she's over there. And she saw my little one then. Is that okay, Zach?
Can you back it up a little bit?
Just
a little
okay. Is that all right? It's a little over the microphone.
Yeah, Yep, that's fine.
Okay. Okay. So I think that's about all that would be pertinent, I think. This is the little, this is the family in the United States. We weren't citizens yet, I don't think, but doesn't have the year there. Okay. Got that.
Anything else that you'd like to before we?
Well, finish? I think that's sort of it. I have.
Did you want to just say about the? You left out about the. You told me during the break about the movie that you were in.
Oh yeah, I should tell you a little bit. It's a very very emotional little movie. It's about a mother who's looking for her little boy, a Polish boy that ran away from a children's home because they were collecting all the orphans and immigrant children, trying to relocate them to Palestine at the time, to Israel. And so the movie... Montgomery Clift is in it, and he's a soldier in Germany, and he happens to find this little boy, and they become friends, and he wants to take him with him to States because he feels, you know, he doesn't know that he thinks he's an orphan. Anyway, the mother is looking for him, and she finally comes to this orphanage, and it's... She finds him. But the reason they wanted me, they wanted a skinny little girl. And I knew the, as they were getting ready to take the children to Israel, they were singing a Hebrew song. And so there's a little close-up of me because I knew the words, you know. So we watch it once in a while. They've cut, I think, my close-up. I can't find it anymore. It's so quick, you know, it's just for a second. But I was picked up in a limousine. I had never been in the car at that point. I was 7. And I think it was a couple of days of shooting, you know, film. And I got a little bit of money, probably $1 or something worth. So
this was still in Switzerland, right?
That was still in Zurich, yeah. I was about 7 at that point, 8 maybe. Probably 8 or 9. And the name of the movie was A Search. If you ever get a chance to see it, it was quite a nice movie.
Okay, anything else before we say it to
I her? Think I've done it. I mean, I'm sure there's more, but you'll get more also from Rachel.
Well, it was an absolute privilege to interview you.
Thank you so much. I hope it was somewhat illuminating.
Certainly was, and it painted a wonderful story and picture of what you went through. So, yeah. One thing, how do you spell that word in German? Say the word and spell it, meaning cooperative in Zurich. You said your parents belonged to a co-op. How do you spell that?
The place was called Flickstube. 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 Which means a little room where they mend things. It was kind of a literal name, but it was organized as a cooperative business, kind of. Mm-hmm.
Very good. Anything? I think that's it. Zach, I think we're done.